それでは、
早
速、第1部を始めていきたいと思います。第1部のテーマは、脱炭素循環経済へのイノベーションというタイトルでございます。このタイトルで、中部大学経営情報学部教授、そして慶応義塾大学名誉教授の津田英二先生にご講演をいただきます。細田先生は、日本の皆様にはもう皆様よくご存知だと思います。環境経済学で、日本を代表する、専門家の方でいらっしゃいます。これまで の環境省、経済産業省、そして東京都の政策にも様々な形で助言をいただきました。プラスチックの問題につきましても、国の審議会の座長を務められて、国の政策の取りまとめにご尽力されていらっしゃいます。それでは、細田先生、よろしくお願いをいたします。
Thank you very much, Mr. Moderator. I am Hosoda from Chubu University. I am at the Circular Innovation Forum and thank you for inviting me. It's a great honor for me. So may I share the screen with you? Just wait a moment, please.I'd like to check with my moderator. Are we sharing the screen? Yes. Thank you. So let me start right away. My given time is 30 minutes, which is quite limited, but I will be punctual. So order doesn't matter, but I will be talking about the innovative business of resource circulation and decarbonization.Sorry to the simultaneous interpreter, but I would speak in ad-lib. I'd just like to share with the audience the experience I had today. During the moon time, I was visiting one of the company engaged in bio power generation. Gradually, they are doing that, working on the decarbonization because bio holds a key.In terms of generation and decarbonization. There are forests in Japan and the trees are cut down for inputs. But inputs are limited and for output, there are many other things apart from the power being generated. So we like to put a circular notion to it. How should we go about it?If we go from the decarbonization, of course, some things which are not desirable will be generated, which means that you have to go circular. And reuse and recycle and so forth. The extra energy should not be used for the decarbonization. Going from the decarbonization, the circulation need to be considered and the resource circulation, if that is an entry point, we also need to.Think about the decarbonization. So I had an impressive visit with that company this afternoon. They are wanting to make it into a viable in terms of commercial term and which was highly encouraging. So having said that, let me start right away. I'd like to point out that there are changes taking place in lifestyle and business styles and so forth. So I am nowthinking that now offers a golden opportunity for the resource circulation and decarbonization because lifestyles and business styles are changing at the same time. It means concretely that of late, there are changes taking place in the preferences of the consumers. Of course, there are products, but more people are interested in option pertaining to the services rather than the product, rental, lease,servicizing. All these attract the attention of the consumers in terms of the options. Instead of owning products themselves, consumers can buy the services. This is a suit I'm wearing, which I bought a long time ago, but suits can be rented. On lease, young people do not own their cars. They could do it well with their rented cars. That has become normal, and accordingly, the business styles are changing together with the lifestyle changes. It's mutually effective. Of course, the personal interests are being pursued, but at the same time, public interest and the welfare can be pursued at the same time, or even can be accelerated. That's how I see it, and I would name some examples later. Of course, we always talk about SDGs, a famous word. There are people who are wearing SDG, ESG, SDG badges. Not only private sector people, but university that I work for, and many other public institutions. All these people are recognizing and sharing the value of SDGs. And there are many forces which advance that, like ESG, investment, environment, society, and governance. Environment, society, and governance. ESG investment is what people are looking for. There are trend which is intensified. Investment companies, famous ones, are saying that all the ESG notion are coming into the products that they handle and invest in. Decarbonization, circular economy are covered by the notion of ESG, of course. And from the financial point of view, a further push is being made behind the promotion of ESG. Well, this kind of trend has always been there in Japan, actually. We didn't use a word like resource circulation or the decarbonization, but during the Edo period in modern times, we are familiar with the Omi merchants who claimed the triple win. Good for sellers, good for buyers, and good for the community. If you're talking about the transaction, the sellers and buyers will be happy, but society and community viewpoint are included. Social welfare in terms of the notion of triple win. So modern businesses used to emphasize the capital, the buyers and sellers, only two parties, but a triple win notion looks into the welfare enhancement for the entire community and society. That is a notion of the Omi merchant. And the modern version have been advocated by Professor Michael Porter of Harvard, a very famous professor, and his group. They advocated creating shared value, which is the idea of the triple win, which used to be in place in Japan during the Edo period around Omi merchant. And the decarbonization and the circular economy are now jointly put together. That is a more concrete form of the triple win. So what are the driving forces of the change? Of course, the government, like Tokyo Metropolitan Government, who are the sponsor of today's seminar. What is important is the lifestyles that we lead. General public has to change, and the businesses have to change, and it works mutually. And they are accelerators. Instead of owning the product, the services are being owned, from commodities to services. And what pushes that forward are the SDG by 2030. The 17 goals and more than 100 targets have been established, and there are ESG investment, as well as creative shared value advocated by Professor Michael Porter. And from the accounting point of view, we are familiar with a triple bottom line, and precursor of ESG investment was the Global Compact. So there are many items included in the platforms, and from lifestyles and business styles, they are working toward the direction of decarbonization and resource circulation. That is a pattern we are seeing. Let me be more concrete. So I told you about the decarbonization and circular economy, and the key word, one of which is a partnership. Partnership can be done where market force cannot work. So we need someone who serves as glue. It can be a national government or Tokyo Metropolitan government, or private businesses even who can serve as a glue. We will hear the examples of the private sector later. So SDGs and ESG investment and the CSV, creative shared value, and the triple win. The pursuit of a personal interest can join force with creating a new economy and are linked with the public welfare as well. The market fundamentalism used to be the mainstay, but I thought this notion was too extreme, personally speaking, until a few years ago. But gradually, the origin of the capitalism of the United States has also started to change the notion. They are emphasizing more public welfare and the community welfare. It's not only a matter of the happiness of seller and the buyer only. We have to look into the societal well-being and public interest, which can be a source of a new economy and new value. That is why we are talking about circular economy and decarbonization, because this notion matches this purpose. It's not only me who thinks in this line. So partnerships are there, and business styles and lifestyles are changing, so are the finances. And decarbonization and circular economy can now become a viable business, which is a very good thing. And it's only natural that, as I said, I believe the circular economy and the decarbonization can hand in hand work in harmony and should work in harmony. Circular economy using lots of energy will not do. Decarbonization was done intensively, but it didn't result in circular economy, just ended in using more energy. That's not it. Circular economy and decarbonization has to proceed in harmony, hand in hand. So we need a technology innovation, of course, and we also need a system innovation. Both of them are very important. People tend to talk only about technological innovation, but the social setup and the system setup also need to be changed in an innovative way. Otherwise, technology cannot be taken advantage of. Well, later on in the symposium, many examples will be presented, and I also like to introduce to you some of the examples myself later. And as I said, in market economy, buyer and seller would transact with each other ever since the Adam Smith period, and both of them will become happy, and that was it. However, when it comes to decarbonization and the circular economy, market economy alone will not be the necessary force. The entity and entity and the business to business, consumer to consumer need to be connected, or C2B or municipalities or the national government. We need some connector, partnership creation. So the private sector, public sector, and the citizens and the industry has to work in harmony and cooperate in creating a new economy. As I said, market economy without partnership will not lead to the decarbonization or circular economy. That's why I say that the partnership is very important where all the entities are being linked together by glue, so to speak. So who will be the major actor? Who will be the coordinators? There are many, it's varied, but the basics are written here. The main actors who play a crucial role in a carbon neutral circular economy are private sectors. So important entity, main actors are the private sectors. It's inevitable. However, coordination or coordinators who realize system innovation are public sectors. Coordinator is a glue, like a national government or municipal government, metropolitan government like Tokyo. Well, of course, sometimes the private sector can play a coordinator role, but in the big area, the coordinator will be served by the public sector as a glue. And in a new economic system, private sector should be given a free hand, which prompts the circulative use of resources and decarbonization. But a coordinator will be usually the public sector or sometimes carbon recyclers. It is anticipated that voluntary actions made by private sectors will contribute to the creation of circular economy and decarbonization. Think about public pollution. National government and local governments were there to regulate and restrict. However, when it comes to decarbonization and circular economy, the innovative technology has to come in. It's not only a matter of a regulation. So creativity and the voluntary action on the part of the private sector will be necessary. But all the public sector and the private sector has to serve as a coordinator carrying the flag. As I said, what is important here is that when we talk about innovation, we mean the system innovation as well as the technology innovation. Just reviewing the screen that I showed you. In case of Japan, it is often the case that we always wanted to catch up with the West, US and Europe, and we tended to emphasize too much the technological side. That is, of course, important in terms of innovation, but why was it that Europe and US was able to advance capitalism because of the system innovation? Because thanks to the system innovation, finances become more flexible, maybe sometimes too much, but it has become flexible, and capitalism had so much flourished. But not only that, we need to be kind to the environment, which requires the social system innovation on top of the technological innovation, and they have to work hand in hand in harmony. This is a diagram that I drew. System innovation. System will change. Why is it that system will change? Because technology is the driver behind it. But today during the daytime, I told you about the company I visited working on the decarbonization, the biopower generation, who takes advantage of the technology. What is important here is that within a given system, the technology will be used effectively, and we have to put it into the circular economy, and that's a problem with the company. The key is held by the system innovation, because the social system has not caught up with it yet. It's in the process of being created. Lifestyles, business styles are changing, but the socio-economic side of the innovation is lagging behind, and Tokyo Metropolitan Government would like to lead the way in changing that. So that's wonderful. Public entities like Tokyo Metropolitan Government is leading the system innovation and trying to change the consumers and businesses styles and in harmony with technology innovation. And the coordinator role is being played by public sector. like we are having this seminar, which is very important. Already these notions have been applied in Europe and US, but it will be so in Asia as well. So system innovation style is different between Japan and Europe or Asia and the United States. So in what way system innovation can be promoted? The partnership holds a key. The partnership status change from region to region. So diversity need to be capitalized on so that the system innovation and technological innovation work hand in hand in harmony, which will become increasingly important going forward. So I know I'm repeating myself that those two have to be in harmony, and the key word is harmonization. Partnership creates a new socio-economic relationship which is harmonized with new technological innovation, realizing a circular economy and decarbonization. It is that the 17th goal of SDG is partnership. But this has not been translated into a good action yet. We are still searching for what to do in terms of action. So a symposium like we're having today can be a hint. So I hope that the good information and knowledge will be shared so that society in harmony with technological innovation will be created. So today I'd like to show you some examples for the partnership. After my presentation, you will hear a series of concrete cases, but I have some examples myself. But name has not been disclosed. The concrete entity will be introduced to you later after my presentation. So this is the first example, which is a case of partnership between private and public sectors. Of course, private businesses have to make some profit, but they also like to serve the interest of the public. What can be done? And public sector can come up with ideas. This is a recycling of the PET PET bottle. It can be made into a film, but recycling onwards is more difficult. It has to be done repeatedly. How about PET-to-PET recycling? There is a technology available for that. There is a technological innovation, but there is no system to support it yet. So municipality can kick in to represent one layer. Then the recycling can be performed. You have on the left-hand side beverage manufacturer, and on the right-hand side is a recycler of a PET bottle. In the middle are recycle people. So there is a recovery and separate refuse collection. So the middle part has to play a good role, otherwise the left-hand side and right-hand side will not be linked. So in the middle will be the municipality body who would serve as a coordinator, mediator, so that PET bottle also will be recovered and sent to the recycler of PET bottles, then that will go back to the beverage manufacturer. Then the circulation will be established. PET-to-PET recycling. Then the energy saving will be done. At least 60% reduction of energy use. You can even go further, as far as I know. And it can eventually reach 100% reduction in energy use. But a partnership will hold the key. Next example, which is another interesting example. Maybe you will hear some of the similar stories later. This is a partnership between the business competitors, competitor to competitor. This is a toilet maker A and maker B who are cooperating with each other. and from supermarkets and other stores. The refillable containers and pouch and packages are collected and achieve scale economy, economy of scale, and work on the collection and the recycling, putting down the cost. So it's the containers will be recycled into the original containers and packages, which is based on the competitor partnership. So I hope this could also get advanced much more to become much more viable business. This is a third example. This is the vertical partnership on product chain. Then the new chemical recycling is being realized. And this is a matter of a horizontal recycling, no downgrade recycling. There is a horizontal linkage, like this beverage maker A and beverage maker B. And the beverages are sold to consumers, and after the use, it will be put to the chemical recycling intermediate dispositioning, and then go to the plastic molders, then go back to the beverage manufacturer, producer. Market economy alone will not make this happen. We need a partnership and platform. That's why this has become possible. So partnership can be a driver for many changes. I know my remaining time is only 5 minutes, so I need to rush. This is a big challenge. Compatibility of circular economy and decarbonization, it's easier said than done. It's very difficult to do it at the same time. Target needs to be set first of all, then lay down the roadmap for achieving that target as near as possible. Japanese people are too serious. They think that they have to put everything into practice overnight, but it's not the case. So target will be set, and sometimes target will be missed. Look at the football and the soccer. So if opposing team scores a point, then you can always catch up and win from behind. So this is a matter of circular economy and decarbonization. It will not go hand in hand, compatible always. Because sometimes extra metal waste may be generated, unintended, that, of course. So what is important here is that from the circular economy side, we have to come up with a waste hierarchy. Let's think about waste hierarchy. So it's only natural that we have to avoid waste generation in the first place. Then even if, despite those efforts, waste is generated, then it will be reused. Then the material recycling can be done, like chemical recycling or heat recovery afterwards. If not, then proper disposition, disposal, and treatment. Of course, there's a heat recovery and incineration and so forth. But if you rely too much on that, then that will be conflicting with the decarbonization. And too much energy will be used for the recycling. And that will defeat the purpose. So innovation will be necessary, and reset will be required from time to time. This is a waste hierarchy in diagram. So avoidance of waste generation, reuse, recycling, heat recovery, and proper disposal and treatment. Thermal recovery and proper disposal and treatment. This portion needs to be minimized as much as possible and go up to the higher hierarchy. We don't have a perfect solution ready yet. I told you about the bio generation, and it will be linked to the circular economy, but it's only on the demonstration stage. It has not been fully achieved. And a hint can be found with a smart community from an emulate. This is the entire picture. The community is one unit. And he talks about the entire community level energy management and linked to the building or home or community energy management system. And in it, there's a e-mobility, hybrid or EV, electric vehicles. All these will be factored in time of a disaster. The electricity can be taken out. And the circular economy is also included. How to couple that? The sharing will become very important. So my time has come, so let me go on to the concluding part. So we talked about circular economy and decarbonization. This is an inevitable selection and option for the new capitalism. We have to go hand in hand. Circular economy and decarbonization will require system innovation and technological innovation at the same time. And both of them have to go hand in hand in harmony. And tools available for that? Of course, market economy is important, but we need partnerships, cooperation, which can be a very effective tool. And we have SDGs, ESG, investment, CSV, creative shared value, and the triple win, traditional notion in Japan. All these can become a pusher and promoter for changing in the society and can be a driving force for pursuing the target. Technological innovation, business innovation, social innovation can get together and partnership will be formed. Then it can do much more than the market economy can do alone. And a new eco society can be created through the circular economy and decarbonization. For that, wisdom and knowledge need to be shared, and efforts have to go on to create a new economy, which will become very important. So time has come. So thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Hosoda. You have talked about the various challenges besetting us today, and your presentation was full of insight. I have one question for the professor. Amongst companies, collaboration will be important, and the government can play the role of the coordinator, as mentioned by the professor. Now, in terms of corporate collaboration, if you look at the different companies, corporate cultures differ, and furthermore, the underlying history differs, and they could be engaged in intense market competition if they are peers in the same industry. So how can we establish a collaboration amongst companies? Today, we will hear from industry leading companies. Kurama will be discussing point as well. But for the industry overall, in terms of the associations, I am sure that initiatives are underway. So how can we overcome the rivalry and conflicting interests to share wisdom and know-how? And please give us your advice.
You made a very important point out, and I always cooperate with a large number of private businesses myself, and you said it correctly. Right on. In case of Japan, for good or worse, there is an industry out there. And sometimes industry, when it comes to environmental issue, they may go backward, not so positive. But recently, there has been a sea change, as said by the moderator. the waste plastics issue is something that the industries are seriously thinking about nowadays. What is important is that you talked about administrative side, but there are people like me who are engaged in education and schools and also NGOs. NGOs are very positive. So diverse way of thinking can be reflected and can be shared. And at last, the trend has changed. So sharing the knowledge is very important for becoming a driver for the movement. I live in Aichi Prefecture, and I have an interaction with many of the local businesses there, inclusive the industry. Sometimes the people are at the loss, don't know what to do. So in a pinpoint way, the ideas can be introduced, then that ring the bell and people will say, oh, that will be the thing. So important point is the timing and the way that you impart your advices and suggestions. That is important. And the third point, which is important, is that within the industry, there are differences. Degree of reactions are different. So environmental top runners can be identified quickly. Then you can share knowledge with that entity. So in Japanese community, people think that, look, they are doing so, why don't we? That's why people are so keen toward SDGs. They are afraid about being late and lagging behind. So this is the mentality part, which can be sort of encouraged in a positive way, identifying top runners and cooperate with that entity, first of all, then it can spread the word widely.
Thank you very much, Professor, for the valuable advice. And thank you very much for the outstanding presentation. This is the end of my presentation. Thank you. Hello, everyone. I will be hearing from various companies about their various initiatives. I would like to introduce myself once again. My name is Furusa of the Bureau of the Environment of the Tokyo Metropolitan Government. Now here, I would like to share a message or communication from the Tokyo Metropolitan Government. On the part of Tokyo Metropolitan Government, DMG, by 2050, we want to achieve zero emission by then, to reach a zero emission, virtually zero, by this time frame. And we have announced the zero emission Tokyo strategy. Energy as well as resources will be covered in the various strategies that will be implemented. However, by 2050, CO2 emissions virtually zero is what we are aiming to achieve. That means that in 10 years up to 2030, the activities within this decade is going to be extremely important. Against this backdrop, in January of this year, the governor announced that Tokyo would reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 50% from 2000 level by 2030 and increase the share of electricity generated from renewable energies sources to 50%. Now, to achieve a 50% reduction, we have to change the behavior amongst the public government business. We are referring to this as a time to act for a carbon half style. Now, regarding the relationship with the circular innovation, in order to reach CO2 zero emissions, we have to fundamentally change our views in terms of resources. The 2050 sustainable use of plastics is being promoted in the form of the carbon closed cycle. The CO2 zero emissions to be realized from these perspective. We will be talking about use as well as in part two and part three, we'll be talking about horizontal technologies That means that reduce and reuse will be promoted to reduce one-way usage. We want to make this a norm in our daily activities. That is the first point. And after that, there will be remaining waste plastic. Similar to virgin plastic, we have to promote a closed loop of recycling in this regard. From these perspectives, the two themes will be the reuse revolution as well as closed loop technologies will be taken up in this forum. And that is the objective of the discussions today. Now, currently, beyond Tokyo, in Tokyo, we are discussing the budget. And we will have a project for implementation of the innovative technology and business models at the TMG in order to concretely implement game-changing new systems and technologies for the sustainable use of plastics in Tokyo and Tokyo metropolitan area. Companies in various fields, such as manufacturers, retailers, logistics, recyclers, should form a network or consortium and discuss who will be responsible for implementing the new systems and technologies. The metropolitan government will support business groups that have ambitious goals and are willing to take concrete actions. Themes include the expansion and mainstreaming of a reuse system for voluntary collection of manufacturers and sellers, and a system for collecting, sorting, and storing waste plastic to be sent to innovative horizontal recycling technologies, both for materials as well as chemicals. On the part of the Tokyo Metropolitan Government, we will provide support for example, partial support for research and demonstration project costs, advice on laws and regulations, consider deregulation of the, and also provide coordination with related administrative agencies. We, if necessary, matching with other projects or other companies will be facilitated. In next year's projects, there will be a selection done through inviting applications. There are cases where TMG will invite participations. Once the budget has been approved, we will announce the details in spring. So we would like to receive active suggestions and participation from the business people who are watching this seminar today. Now, this is the end of the first part. We will be proceeding to part two from 5:50, which is in 5 minutes' time. So let's take a break for 5 minutes. To the right, there is a QR code. This is for the questionnaire survey. We would like to ask for your cooperation in filling in the questionnaire. When you cooperate in the questionnaire, there will be another indication for questionnaire at the end, which you can skip. And now we shall take a break for 5 minutes. We will be resuming once again from 5:50. Thank you.
皆様お待たせいたしました。それでは第2部、
リユース。Thank you very much for waiting. We would now like to proceed to part 2, which is on the topic of the reuse revolution. We will be hearing from the business examples for reduce, reuse and recycle. We have four speakers in this part 2.When English is spoken by the presenter, you can also use the interpretation function of Zoom to receive the information in Japanese translation. We will first hear from Loop Japan. The speaker will be Mr. Eric Kawabanta of Asia Pacific General Manager.As you know, Loop Japan is now promoting the business model that enables the repeated use of containers for daily necessities and food products. Eric-san, over to you. Time allocated will be 15 minutes.
Okay, thank you very much, Rusa-san. It's a pleasure to be with everybody today. My name is Eric Kawabara. I'm the APAC General Manager for TerraCycle and Loop. And I'm going to share my screen, just a moment. So TerraCycle and Loop are social enterprise businesses. Actually, we're based in the United States and we operate in various countries around the world.Loop, the reuse platform, was launched in the United States about a year and a half ago, and it operated on the East Coast in an e-commerce model. It also launched about 18 months ago as well in France and Paris, also as an e-commerce model. Recently, we have started selling Loop products in-store in France, and we're expanding to the Asia region this year, starting in Tokyo, and then in the fall in Sydney, Australia.We work with many partners around the world. You know, reuse and sustainability it's a really big conversation, and it requires a lot of stakeholders to succeed. And so we work with many partners, from private companies to government, to retailers, consumers all around the world to achieve these things. So when we thought about the Loop platform and reuse, we wanted to examine the history of reuse and why reuse.Disappeared for the most part from consumer products. And when we look at waste, you know, we need to understand where it comes from. And we do know waste is something that is not existing in nature. It's human made, right? It's consumption, complex materials, it's consumerism. It's a human invention. And if we go back 100 years, there really wasn't a lot of disposable items. We bought things with the intention of keeping them and using them for a long time.But in the 1930s and 1940s in the United States, this throwaway lifestyle, disposable packaging, was introduced to the world. And you know, you can see it was very prevalent because, well, it's convenient. And you can see in on the left-hand side here, this is an excerpt from Life magazine, a throwaway living, disposable items cut down on your household chores. You could see many advertisements during that period about how convenient disposability is.Right? Reuse can be really tedious. Why not just throw it away? And, you know, this really started us down a different path. We did live in a relatively circular world at that time. And we started down the path of a linear economy where we extract, we manufacture, we use, and we dispose. And the impact of this has, I think, been incredible. It's a world crisis.We have a global crisis of plastic waste around the world. Every country, it contributes, every country suffers from this. And I think back in the 1930s and 40s, when we invented disposable packaging, I really don't think we knew what was going to happen. And, you know, in this linear economy, mostly, you know, we end up burning, landfilling, and in countries that are not as developed, that don't have as good infrastructure, right, it actually ends upin the waterways and the ocean. And so, you know, we originally, for the last, you know, almost 20 years, focused on recycling. on trying to move things that were non-recyclable because of economic factors to become recyclable. And it's really difficult because as you can see, you know, things that are easy to recycle, they're monomaterials, they have relatively good market value. The systems are high volume, and the cost of recycling is lower than the resulting material value. Whereas on the right, so many things that are non-recyclable are complex materials, they're expensive to recycle, and thus they're not recycled because the resultant value cannot cover the cost of recycling. And this is the economics, the value chain that needs to exist to make post-consumption waste recyclable. If there's not adequate material value to cover the costs, then it just won't happen. Well, you know, COVID has exacerbated this, and the prices of oil also contribute to this as well. So, you know, the lower oil prices are, the cheaper virgin materials are, the less likely someone is to buy recycled plastic. And this has gotten, you know, even worse with COVID. You can see 40%+ of end markets have stopped accepting plastics from recyclers, such that plastic film, right? Of course, it's if it's recycled, it's a lower quality than virgin in many ways. You can't even pay people to take it, and it's creating negative value. And as packaging becomes lighter and cheaper and lighter and cheaper as it has through the years, again, the value chain is really difficult to build. You know, and so it's a really difficult thing to achieve this holy grail of cradle to cradle. You melt something, you lose certain properties, right? You lose value, and it's really hard to put it back into packaging. You know, we've tried, and you know, we've done some different things where we can actually make other products, you know, but it's really difficult to go cradle to cradle. And so when we examined this issue of reuse, right, what happened and you know why it disappeared, we really wanted to find out, is there a way to bring it back? Is there a way to make this work to get people to accept the platform again? And we developed a platform called Loop. And you can see this is the announcement of Loop, thanks to the Tokyo government who partnered with us. We've got many partners in the Japanese private sector, about 12 at the end of beginning of 2020. And now in 2021, we've got about 26 contracted partners. Globally, there are about 200 CPGs with 400 products on the platform now. Now, you know, Loop is, it's not a complicated thing, right? It's really borrowing wisdom from the past, that old reuse model like the milkman, where the milk company owned the bottle and sold the contents to you. They would retrieve the bottle post-consumption, clean it, sterilize it, refill it, and use it again. It was the property of the milk company. Now, when you own the bottle, to lower your costs, what do? You want to make it last a long time, so you make it durable, right? Now, when you shift to disposable packaging, right, you're now selling both the product content and the packaging as a single unit product, right? But what happens here, right? The packaging is no longer your asset as a manufacturer. The packaging now is a cost. And what do we as private companies try to do with costs? Naturally, we try to lower costs, right? And we started down this pattern, right, of making packaging cheaper and lighter and cheaper and lighter. And as we said, you know, in the value chain equation, if resultant material value from recycling is not greater than the cost of recycling, what happens to recyclability, right? You can see from glass to aluminum to PET to package melt packs and all the way down to flexible plastic packaging, recycling rates go from 89% and continue down a slippery slope to 0%. And this is what has happened. And so when we designed Loop, we really wanted to address, right, the issue of why disposability, right? One, well, it's because it's cheap and it's convenient. And in order for reuse to make a comeback, we have to address these two very important factors. So of course, the first one is cost, right? If you make a package out of plastic, you could probably make this, you know, for 10 cents, for example. If you want to take that same plastic package and replace it with something that can be used many times, you have to make it durable. So you have to make it out of different types of materials. For example, stainless steel, However, you can't make the same package from stainless steel for 10 cents, right? It's impossible. It might cost you $3. It's much more expensive, right? You would lose money if you sold it for the same price if you made that package out of stainless steel. But what would happen if you could use it 100 times? If you could recover it, wash it, and refill it, and use it numerous times, the amortized cost per sale, right, theoretically can go down. Maybe even to a point where it can become equal to the cost of disposable packaging per sale, maybe better in the future. Now, what else can happen, right? If you can spend more money on a package because you're going to reuse it, not only can you make it more durable, you can also make it more beautiful, right? You can add design. You can add, right, new functionality to the package. I mean, this is, you know, it's not a critical function, but for many people in the United States, they eat ice cream directly from the containers and their hands get very cold. Or maybe they want to eat their ice cream and watch a movie, right? And they want to set it aside for a while. Well, it might melt. Well, this is what would happen if you have a paper package, right? A typical cardboard ice cream package could not, right, could not address those issues. But what if you had a reusable container that was made out of a dual component of stainless steel? Well, this particular Häagen-Dazs package, right, it is two layers, two components. And if you put your hand on the outside, it doesn't feel cold. If you put the lid on, because of the dual layers, there's a cushion of air, right, between the inside and outside layers, so that if you leave it outside with the lid on, it can stay frozen for 4 hours. Not possible with a throwaway package, but possible, right, with a beautiful, durable package, right? And that's the idea behind Loop, right? We want to give benefit back to the consumer, right, to compete with cost, right? And we want to compete, right, with convenience. We want to add benefits to the consumer through the power of design. And these are some examples of Loop packaging. So going from a plastic wet tissue or wipe dispenser to a beautiful stainless dispenser, right? Which when you close, keeps your, right, wipes wetter for a longer period of time. And it also looks nice. It goes with your interior. Cooking oil or mayonnaise. Laundry detergent from plastic to stainless containers. Biscuit containers going from, right, paper packages to airtight, closable metal packaging, which also looks quite nice. Even pet food. A lot of people buy pet food in flexible plastic packaging only to transfer it to airtight containers themselves, which you have to clean. But what if it already came in that beautiful airtight container and someone else cleaned it for you? Wouldn't that be great? Right? Going from plastic to aluminum or beautiful stainless steel packaging for hair care as well. You know, and even this is an example, right, of reuse, right? It's really difficult to reuse plastic pumps. So Unilever worked together with Loop and a packaging company to develop a pump, which is stainless steel, which can be reused more than 10 times and cleaned. You know, so this is really driving different types of innovation in the platform. And this is an example of what some of the products in Loop in the Japanese domestic market, which will be, you know, introduced this spring, will look like as well. Beautiful, durable, functional, reusable packaging. Now, you know, Loop doesn't just accept any type of packaging into the platform. There have to be some rules, right? These rules are not developed by Loop ourselves, but in conjunction with the World Economic Forum, with Greenpeace, with packaging companies, and with many consumer product companies and local government, national government as well, around the world. So there are a couple of rules, right? Rule number one, it has to be reusable for at least 10 times, right? It has to be strong enough to be reused 10 times, right? From an LCA perspective, the materials used once, right, they become worn out, have to be recyclable back into themselves. And finally, that container has to be cleanable or can't be reused, right? The other objective to make a successful reuse platform is, can I access this platform without changing my lifestyle dramatically? Right? So Loop is designed this way. It's the same distribution model as a disposable product. You shift from reuse, from disposable to reusable, and you sell it through the same channels that you do now, right? So it goes through the same channels as a regular product does, right? And it's built to be accessible, very accessible. So you can buy it online on the left, or you can buy it in your store, right? The same thing, like you do a normal product. You take it home on step number two. Once you're done, right? If it's through e-commerce, we pick it up, take it away and clean it and refill it. If it's through, right, a grocery store or supermarket, right? When you buy your groceries, right? You take them home, right? You use them, you consume them. But next time you go to the supermarket, you can take your empty package with you and return it at the supermarket. Again, not altering your lifestyle, right? Building reuse into your current lifestyle, right? And taking those packages, washing them and using them again. And this is how, you know, this is how Loop would look in a section, for example, in Japan, in an Aeon store or Kroger store, right? Or Carrefour store in France. And this is the experience, you know, you go in, you find the Loop section, right? And I'm going to just show you a little video of how it works. So this is the simple consumer journey. You buy your Loop product in your store in a reusable package. And you purchase it just like you would any other product in the store. You pay a price for the product, and you pay a deposit on the package, and you take that product home and use it. And when you're done using it, when you go shopping for new products again, you go to the store and you have two return options. You can return it in a really convenient Loop tote bag. You use an application to read a barcode so we know who returned it. Or if you just want to return one item at a time, you can put a QR code sticker on it, read it into your account so we know you returned it, so we can return your deposit. And as simple as that. And, you know, we want to ask...
Philip-san, ごめんなさい.
Okay. And so it's, you know, we want to make this available in many formats, in supermarkets, in fast food stores, right? And people love the platform because of the convenience, because of the packaging, you know, and because it reduces waste in their home. Again, we plan to expand this not just through retail, but even through, for example, reusable bento boxes, which is sponsored through a project we've done with the Tokyo government. And we'll soon be announcing the results of that as well. And this was run in Tokyo in a department store with reusable food containers and with office buildings with reusable bento boxes. And that's it, that's the dream. We hope that this becomes an attractive, sustainable platform that consumers, right, manufacturers and retailers will embrace. And we can help reduce waste in Japan. Thank you very much.
Erickson, thank you very much for the outstanding presentation. I'm sorry that we didn't have enough time. I would like to introduce the next speaker. There is going to be a change in the order. From Czech, Swiss, and Germany, we will be, Switzerland, we will be hearing from MIWA. Mr. Robert Van Tilburg will be talking on the topic of sustainability and impact, please.
Yeah, okay, I think that's my cue. Thank you very much for that introduction. I will also try to share my screen now. I think that should work now. So hi, everyone. Thank you for the invitation. We're really happy to speak here today. I'm Robert. I am Sustainability Impact Officer at MIWA. I'm very happy to be introducing MIWA here today. It's great to hear about the other solutions. Thank you, Loop Japan, for that wonderful introduction. I think we have a very similar vision of how we would like to see the world in the near future. Miva is a technology company driven as well by a mission to prevent the creation of waste from single-use packaging. And the word prevention is crucial for us there. We believe that it's essential to prevent waste before it happens and to keep valuable materials in closed loops. We are a young company in Prague, in the Czech Republic, in the EU, and we provide a reusable packaging system. It's not just about reusable packaging alternative alone, but Miva provides a complete business ecosystem for smart reusable packaging. And it's an ecosystem because we involve all stakeholders in the supply chain. So that includes the producers and brand owners, as well as the retailers and the end consumers. What Miva revolves around is the reusable capsule. That's the one that you see here on this slide. And it sort of lies at the heart of our solution. I will get back to how that works precisely a little bit later, but first I'd like to take a step back and discuss what exactly is the problem that Miva is trying to solve. So as Loop Japan also already introduced, consumer packaging is maybe one of the most iconic emblems of the linear economy. What we see is that packaging is produced and then sent to a producer. A producer fills it with a food or non-food product, then packs it again in the type of secondary packaging, which is usually a big cardboard box, so that it can be sent to a retailer. And then that cardboard box gets wrapped again with some plastic cover to protect the box during transportation, the tertiary packaging. Now, once this box arrives at the retailer, the first thing the retailer does is to remove the secondary and tertiary packaging. And at this point, we already have a pile of waste. Then the product itself is being sold to the consumer, of course, and the primary packaging turns into waste at the level of the household. These are various steps of what we consider unnecessary waste production. And we provide a packaging alternative that can make sure that the resources that we use can actually be used in closed loops. So how do we do that? Miva redefines packaging into a reusable and scalable solution for producers, brand owners, retailers, and mainstream consumers. The word scalable is important for us here because we believe that in order to make an impact, in order to make sure that we can actually replace single-use packaging at a large scale, the product needs to offer some advantage over single-use packaging. And that is actually possible because of the reuse aspect. In the previous presentation, it was already mentioned that once you start reusing packaging, it's possible to improve the design, for example, make it look more attractive and add all sorts of features. At Miva, we've added smart technology to our reusable packaging. And because of that, the whole system becomes much more intelligent. It offers benefits that single-use packaging could never. I will go a little bit into more detail later on, but I realize that so far this has maybe been quite abstract, and I think a video could explain Miva and what Miva looks like much better than I could do with words. So this is what Miva looks like actually through the eyes of the consumer. But what can the consumer actually buy through Miva? At this moment, it is possible to buy approximately 250 different product types through MIWA. That includes, for example, nuts and dried fruits, rice and pasta, legumes, but also instant drinks like coffee, as well as non-foods like dry pet food, washing powder, salt, soap flakes, etc. Some of these categories are especially impactful. Like, I don't know how this is in Japan, but in the Czech Republic, nuts, for example, tend to come in these tiny plastic packages, which also have a plastic lid and some extra plastic foil to preserve the freshness. Like, those types of foods, MIWA can have a especially big impact in. We continually try to expand the product range for MIWA in co-development with our partners, and also by improving MIWA's technology. And this year, we will actually be launching MIWA for liquids as well. That is non-food liquids, such as shampoo, soaps, creams, but also household detergents. So I already mentioned that MIWA system is based on the enrichment of the reusable packaging with smart technology. And I want to explain a little bit how that works precisely. So here you see MIWA's applications, both on the business-to-business side and the business-to-consumer side. It all revolves around that capsule, which you see in the middle of the slide. This capsule rotates between producers and retailers. A producer can fill this capsule, seal the capsule in-house, and then send it to a retailer. And the retailer clicks it into the MIWA shelves from where the product can be dispensed to consumers. Now, both the capsule and the shelves are smart. That is to say that they are both connected to a cloud system. This offers some advantages. The capsule and the smart shelves work in tandem. That means that the shelves know exactly what type of product is in the capsule, which means that the dispensing flow can be optimized for the product, for example. But it also means that the producer and the retailer know at any moment what is in every single capsule, where that capsule is, what the expiration date is of the food that's in the capsule, and how much has already been sold of that particular capsule. On the other side of the spectrum, there is the business to consumer application. That is the MIWA cup, a reusable cup, and the MIWA application, phone application. The reusable cup can connect to the rest of the MIWA packaging system, so that if a consumer shops through the cup, they know exactly what type of product they're buying, how much they're buying. You can pay through the application, and the application will immediately update you on the nutritious value of the product that you're buying, as well as the impact, for example, that you're making by buying through a reusable system instead of a single-use packaging system. So this smart design offers some benefits. At the business-to-business level, for example, one great benefit is the possibility to have targeted recalls. If a producer would know at any moment something went wrong with the filling of the capsule, they can just recall that one particular capsule and they always know where it is. It's even possible when the capsule is already installed in the smart dispensers to block it in 1 second so that nothing can be sold from it anymore. Another new advantage is the possibility to build brand loyalty. The MIWA application works in tandem with the rest of the packaging system, which makes it very easy for the retailer to come up with all sorts of customized and creative loyalty schemes. So when you combine all of these features together, we can see how MIWA closes the loop in the usage of its own materials. So this diagram visualizes that. On the left side, you see the packaging is produced. There you see the MIWA capsule, which is sent to a producer, and the producer will fill it in-house. Once the capsule is filled, the producer can seal and close the capsule both digitally and physically. The capsule then moves to the retailer without any secondary or tertiary packaging necessary, and is installed almost on a click basis into the smart dispensers. From there, the product can be dispensed to the consumer. Ideally, the consumer shops into a reusable container as well, takes it home, and can shop from that reusable container as often as the consumer wants. Once the capsule that is installed at the retailer is empty, The capsule can be cleaned by Amoeba Partner. The cleaning is very easy because we know exactly what was in every single capsule and can then be sent to the next producer. This can be a different producer or the same one, depending on what is optimal, which is very easy to see on the basis of the data that can be collected through the Amoeba system. The capsules can be used at least 300 times, and once they reach their end of life, they are made in such a way that they can be easily recycled and the material can be used again for the creation of new packaging. So the system is designed to make impact, and we hope to make impact in two ways. The first way is by driving change in what we see as still a mostly linear world. We hope to encourage a general mind shift from consuming packaging to using packaging, where people actually appreciate the value of the material itself, want to take good care of it, and actually want to reuse it as well. We want to empower users to decide freely how they want to buy goods. When you buy a packaging of a single-use packaging, then you don't really know what the material is. You bring it into your home, it turns into waste, and you don't really know what happens to it afterwards. But when you use a reusable cup, you know exactly what the material is, and you are in control. Finally, we want to create a sense of community around the concept of reuse and bring people together around this concept. That's what we do, for example, with a marketing campaign that we work together on with our partners like Intermarché, which you see visualized on the right side of this slide, where we say it takes just 7 seconds to reuse and make impact yourself. Of course, there is the environmental impact, which is created through the technology directly. Amoeba can deliver a 71% lower environmental footprint than single-use packaging. And this is because of several reasons. The most obvious one, perhaps, is the fact that you create less packaging waste. Amoeba can reduce waste generation by 90%. But there are other benefits as well. Amoeba, for example, also generates lower CO2 emissions because you need less resources and you don't need to incinerate or recycle the resources that often. As a result, Amoeba can lower the carbon footprint by 62%. Where do we stand today? Right now, Amoeba is in store with about 7 producers and we have 6 more onboarded. And together with those producers, we have about 1,400 products which are ready for sale. Products are being sold right now in France, the Czech Republic, and Switzerland, but this year we'll also have new installations in Germany and Austria. Of course, the product range will expand also this year as Amoeba for Liquids becomes available. And something that is quite exciting for us is that the first Amoeba shells have been shipped to the United States already, where they will be tested in cooperation with producer partners there. To finish, I just want to show 2 installations of Amoeba that exist already. Here you see a Amoeba installation with Nestlé in Switzerland. And what you can see really well here is how the Amoeba module or the smart shells have been branded entirely for that particular producer. So all space on the Amoeba module has been used to show and distinguish the brand. In contrast, you see an installation here at Intermarché in France, where you see that the Amoeba module is more decorated in style with the retailer, and the branding and the product information is given on every single capsule that can be installed into the module. So this also shows the possibility to use design on top of the smart technology to enrich the reusable packaging system. So this is Amoeba in a nutshell. Thank you very much for providing the platform today.
Thank you very much. That was very interesting, I'm sure. The Japanese industry will be very interested in what you are providing. Thank you very much. Next speaker will be Aikasa CEO in the Tokyo metropolitan area in the umbrella sharing business is being promoted. The speaker will be Mr. Shoji Marukawa of Aikasa. I hope you can hear me. Yes, we can. So, I will be speaking in Japanese. Let me share my screen with you. How do you do? My name is Maruka of iCasa. iCasa is the only business that we are promoting, although the company name is different. Let me introduce the business to you. As a company, on the part of iCasa, we want to make people happy and comfortable, even on a rainy day. So we want to make people psychologically happy as well. The reason why we started iCasa is because when I was a university student, I used to buy umbrellas all the time, or I would go home drenched. So I'm sure all of you have experienced the same. So people don't want to buy umbrellas. And there is also the experience of not wanting to get wet by the rain. So people have many umbrellas at home, but they still have to buy one if they want to avoid becoming wet when there is sudden rain. So this is a dilemma for everyone. And I wanted to surmount this challenge. That is the reason why I started this company. And we have already experienced the third fiscal year of the company. And we have received investment from various companies. We are a company that is continuing to grow. Currently, we have 10 full-time employees, and there are about 20 people overall in this business. Marui Group, as well as JR East, is our investors. We wanted to create an infrastructure to make people happy on a rainy day. So let me introduce how this system works. So when there is sudden rain, people become wet, this is an umbrella sharing that is provided through an app. And with the app, you are able to borrow an umbrella anytime. QR code will be read, and similar to the other service introduced, you can access the umbrella. There is a lock here. So you can only borrow the umbrella if you have registered, and very low price, 70 yen per day is the charge for the use of the umbrella. Now, people do not view the weather forecast every day. There are people who do not want to carry an umbrella when they are commuting on trains. And ultimately, people don't want to purchase an umbrella. It's only about 500 or 600 yen, but it is wasteful to purchase an umbrella and incur this cost. These are the current challenges. So people feel very gloomy on a rainy day. Therefore, through the iCasa, we are providing an experience of not becoming wet on a rainy day. So that has been the focus of our company. By having the umbrella sharing service, we can overcome this gloomy rainy day. Let me introduce who are the users. In the Tokyo metropolitan area, when there is a rain, because there are 10 million in population, 20% or 30% are in a situation of not having the umbrella when it's raining. It's about 3 out of 4 or 2 out of 4. So with one rain, 150,000 people are purchasing umbrellas. And it's only in Japan that people are purchasing umbrellas. Single-use umbrellas are not used. This is a problem unique to Japan. It doesn't exist in other countries. This is because the plastic umbrellas have become readily available in Japan. People are using umbrellas on a single-use basis. So what are we providing on the part of ICASA will be introduced. The way in which we are providing services will be explained. Using apps, we have digital management identifying the availability of umbrellas and management of the usage, as well as a settlement payment can be made as well. And this is based on unmanned management, which means that cost is lower and it can be installed anywhere. So we have introduced the ID into umbrella sharing. This is the unique characteristic of our business. It is very cheap. It can be unlimited use plan and also 70 yen per day. Very reasonable prices are provided. Now, we have created the umbrellas to overcome the challenges that we are facing. Saila is a company that is manufacturing the umbrellas. And we are using this umbrella. It is a very unique umbrella. This month, there are many days that are rainy and windy. And when there is a windy weather, umbrellas can break very easily. But we have very durable umbrellas being used. When there is a problem, usually it is disposed of. But for the umbrellas that we have introduced, even when one part is broken, it can be repaired very easily by replacing that particular part. This is as per design. So even when users break the umbrella, we don't have to charge the user. We will collect the umbrella, repair, and then reintroduce into the system. By so doing, we don't have to dispose of any broken umbrellas. We have been able to reduce the cost by a factor of 20. So this is the type of umbrella features we have. And I mentioned that it is IT enabled. IC chips are incorporated into the umbrella. So each unit can be managed using ID. So the ID will be identified for each umbrella, and other umbrellas will not be accepted by the system. So apps will be used, and a QR code will be read, and lock will be unlocked, and umbrella can be accessed. Now, as previous speaker has mentioned, one umbrella can be used many times repetitively. That is also the case for our product as well. Repetitive reuse is enabled. And as mentioned in part two, which is the reuse revolution, we are providing high quality, durable umbrellas. So even when it is used hundreds of times, there will be no problem because of our design. That means that usage per cost can be reduced significantly. That is the business logic of our system. Now, upon return, you might wonder how much we are receiving returns. Career payment, or we can have a credit card payment. But we can identify a person using the umbrella, and it will have an impact on the charge made. Therefore, the disadvantage of not returning the ICASA umbrella will mean that user will be motivated to return the umbrella. Currently, the return rate is 99.5%. So unless you lose it somewhere, on a rainy day, it could be lost. It may not be covered in such cases, but basically in 99.5% of the time, we have our umbrellas returned. And that is the reason why we have sound management. For I would also like to talk about what we are doing with the disposable plastic umbrellas as well. On a rainy day, we can access the umbrella anytime, so we don't have to consume new umbrellas. And it is using app, so once you register, you can reduce the cost. It is easier than purchasing at a convenience store. This is right in front of you. And the quality of the umbrella is very high, and there is no waste. So it is full of advantages. That means that, as I have mentioned, earlier, the consumption of plastic umbrellas are likely to undergo significant change. In Japan, there's not been significant discourse regarding disposable plastic umbrellas, but it is now increasingly receiving focus. There is, I think it's number one or number two in terms of lost items. And according to recycle vendors, it is very difficult to recycle because different materials are attached to each other. So the ratio of recycling is unknown. But by using our iGASA, we have identified how much CO2 emissions can be reduced. So you can take notes if you wish. Regarding the way we calculate, we are using the information of the Ministry of Environment. There is a calculation method for the reduction of CO2 at offices, and we have taken reference from this. With one rental, we are able to reduce the CO2 emissions by 692 grams. So going forward, we can not only introduce this in towns, but we can also provide this for companies as well. If we are able to make a headway, I'm sure that significant CO2 emissions can be reduced. Therefore, by providing the experience on not getting wet and accessing our umbrellas means that we can reduce the usage of plastic umbrellas. This is a very important indicator for us. Now, we have talked about systems as well as technological innovation. This will be very important to establish a sustainable society. We also share this importance with the payment through apps on the smartphones. It would be difficult, but the previous speaker also talked about online payment. And there is also the possibility of partnering with major companies, which will accelerate the process. I think we have been able to take advantage of these factors. We have our system installed in around 300 stations nationwide for JR. We have established in the system in these stations, and mainly for railway companies, we have this installed because once they reach the station, if it's raining, they are compelled to purchase a plastic umbrella or not able to move from that location. In order to provide a solution, our service is evaluated very highly. So we are providing the uses of trains to provide a convenience to consumers on a rainy day. This will lead to the reduction of plastic umbrella consumption. These companies have subsidiaries as well as offices with the convenience stores. selling the plastic umbrellas, but nevertheless, these companies have introduced systems because of the importance of providing convenience to the customers, and they feel that 10 years down the road, it would be inconceivable for people to purchase umbrellas. So with the support of many partners, we are able to promote our business. This is the third year of our business, and slow, one by one, we have been able to expand our business, working with the various private sector companies as well as municipalities. We cannot do this alone. We would not be able to install these umbrellas, but we have been able to come up with a system and receive support from private sector companies. By so doing, we have been able to realize this service. It is very important to have a collaboration between the private sector company and the government. And we have also benefited from this collaboration. Now, this is the installation view. In the station, three units or four units have been installed. So I hope you will avail yourself of this service because after all, we are approaching the rainy season. We are running out of time. Can you conclude in 1 or 2 minutes? Now, in terms of our target, currently we have 15,000 people purchasing plastic umbrellas. By increasing our service by 10 times or 20 times, I hope that we will be able to reduce the usage of one-way plastic umbrellas. We are also collaborating with companies in this way and looking for other partners as well, increasingly expanding our business. We are grateful that we have been able to grow our business together with our partners. We shall continue to look for companies that we can work with. With this, I would like to conclude. Thank you. Maruka-san, thank you very much. This is a young startup company from Japan, and I was very much impressed by the presentation. I'm sorry that the order has changed, but now from Singapore, San Francisco, and Hong Kong, reusable cup has been provided by a company called News, and we will now have Claudio de Heyerson and providing a presentation. And please start your presentation.
Hi, good afternoon.
Hello, thanks for having us.
Thank you very much for today.
Thank you. We will be sharing our screen shortly.
Sorry, yeah, one moment. Okay, so how Muse started. Essentially, Muse was founded on the island of Bali. We had really experienced a problem there with single-use waste in the oceans, on the streets, in the communities, and really just wanted to see if we could make an impact and see if we could change essentially how the way people consume and see and view single-use. 50 years of consumption behavior has left our world in a fragile state. And it's true, you know, less than 9% of plastic has been recycled overall. And we essentially need to find better infrastructures and ways that we can essentially incorporate reuse models and systems into our communities, into our world. bioplastics aren't going to be the solution long-term because of high cost and challenged specialized back-end processing. Recycling can only do so much within certain jurisdictions. A lot of places don't offer it. You know, here in the US, for example, you know, we don't actually take back some of the recycling, we send that out. So there's a lot of restrictions that come with recycling. And then human health is obviously a big issue as well that we've seen with bioplastics, microplastics, and leaching, and just essentially just some concern there with how quickly plastics are being produced and plastics are being consumed. So Muse essentially wanted to come up with a solution for how we can incorporate circular economies. The way that it works is you go into a cafe that's in within the Muse system, you download the application beforehand, you then will go and borrow a cup. The barista will provide it for you. It's clean and sanitized there. You will then use it for up to 14 days, as long as you'd like, and then you can return it back to any of our participating cafes within the network, where it is then washed, sanitized, and put back out for redistribution. We found that this was the best way to be able to incorporate this into not only communities, but campuses, offices, and essentially just be able to grow the system out in different ways. The products that we have today are a 16 and a 12 ounce stainless steel cup, different versions for our different markets. So we have the one to the left in Canada and in the United States. And then we offer the middle product in Singapore and Hong Kong as well, with our food box only being offered in Singapore at the moment. But you know, this year is definitely bringing us towards expansion, and we are really happy to see how we're going to be able to grow and continue to grow out reuse products for tomorrow and incorporation. You know, we see this as a building opportunity to not only go into the takeaway sector and be able to help eliminate single use in that aspect, but then also grow into reusable containers and other household goods, cleaners, daily products, things like that. Muse has a smart system to be able to also track this information and to see individualized, serialized QR codes is how our products operate. And yeah, it's been an amazing journey so far to see how far reuse has come in the past 3 years and how much it's expanding and continuing to grow. And we only see great things from here moving forward.
Thanks, Britt. I do not know if you've mentioned before, but Muse stands for multiple use. For those that are wondering out there, what does Muse stand for? It is multiple use. So we wish to eradicate single use. So the first step to get started with us is to download our app, as you can see in the platform. So it's fairly easy. You just sign up, you download the app in the App Store or in the Google Play. You sign up and then you will get access to lots of cafes in different regions. So for example, I am based in Singapore, whereas my colleague Brittany is based in San Francisco. We also have other locations in Hong Kong and also in Toronto. One more that we have a partnership with is in Jakarta in Indonesia. So our app is elegant and you have a familiar experience, and it's very user-friendly for both customers and cafes. So our main partners are the cafes. So we onboard them completely for free. We have two different services when it comes to our journey. So there is Muse on the go and Muse home delivery. So when it comes to Muse on the go, we are referring to the process of takeaway. Britt, could you please bring the slide a bit down? Thank you. So when it comes to the journey on the go, the first step that we do is ordering takeaway at one of our participating F&B outlets. Just after downloading the Muse app, you will scan the QR code on the container, on the reusable container. Then after that, you will have 14 days to use your containers, which are cups and food boxes. Then after these 14 days, you will return the containers to our F&B partners. The F&B partners will sanitize it, cleaning according to standard cleanliness procedures and using dishwasher to clean the containers. And after that, we are all ready for reuse once again, and the journey restarts. When it comes to the home delivery, just a bit up still on the home delivery page. So home delivery is a different process. We are partnering with two services in Singapore called GrabFood and Foodpanda, which are food delivery apps. And so in this way is slightly different. So we start by checking the participating cafe partners on the Foodpanda app, for example, and then you can opt in for reusable containers, reusable Muse containers. Once you've completed your order, you will get the reusable containers at your home. It's sent by, a motorbike service, transportation service. And then once you have them, you just have to scan once again the QR code placed on the containers. And then once again, you have 14 days to return these containers to the F&B partners that will clean and sanitize all the containers. So it's a really, really convenient service for our customers, and also is a very simplified way of collaborating with our partners, because not much effort is necessary. So when it comes to our verticals, we have been collaborating obviously with cafes, restaurants, university campuses, office parks, airports. We've been doing a couple of events as well. So we have really tried our best to eradicate single use, but we are still on the process of that. As mentioned, food delivery partnerships is one of our most recent partnerships that started due to the COVID-19 situation, mostly in Singapore. As everything was shut down, it was really essential to provide an alternative to single use for food delivery services. And finally, we are also collaborating with corporates like Reuse Platform for multinational SPG and F&B companies. So now I would like to show you some examples of what that looks like in Singapore and Hong Kong. You can see our reusables on the top. You can see people enjoying a picnic and going around Singapore on the left side. Then on the right side, you see our reusable system in Hong Kong, together with our partner Swire Properties. And then further on, you can see our partnerships in Canada, as well as in Indonesia, Jakarta. And we also have plans to continue expanding worldwide. So basically, as mentioned, we are present in Toronto, San Francisco, Hong Kong, Singapore, Jakarta, but we are also in active discussions with Brazil, Germany, South Africa, and so on. So it's been really encouraging to see a lot of people joining our mission of eradicating single use. And so this is our team. It's still a small team as we are a startup, but we've been doing a lot of progress together, and we hope to continue this journey. And we would love if you would join us in this journey of eradicating single use. Thank you so much, everyone. If you have any questions, let us know. Brittany, if you want to add anything else, please feel free.
Thank you very much. Appreciate your time.
どうもありがとうございました。あの先ほどの地図で、日本のところにも、白いマーク。
Thank you very much. There was a mark on Japan. So you're going to introduce in Japan as well? Is that the case?
はい、ありがとうございます。
Well, thank you.
ミュー様、大変ありがとうござい
ます。Thank you very much, Muse. Next.I'm sorry that we are slightly behind the schedule, but let us proceed. I beg your indulgence. In the part one, in the second part, we heard from four companies. Now we will proceed to the next part. Now proceeding to part three.It is from 55 minutes past. So unfortunately, we have to do without the break and proceed with part three. In part three, we will have four presentations from these four speakers. So let us proceed to part three, new technologies in the closed loop.Recycle. The first speaker will be from Cuoma, from Mr. Nambu of the Carl Corporation. Mr. Nambu, over to you. I hope you can see my screen. Yes, we can. So let me start. Hello, everyone. Good evening. My name is Nambu of the Recycling Science Research Center of Kao. Thank you very much for this opportunity. I would like to express my gratitude to the organizers. Now, on my part, I would like to talk about the innovation from Japan created by corporate alliances. So that will be the topic. So it is not on the part of Kao, but I'd like to talk about the activities of CLOMA. So I don't think it's necessary to share this information to the participants, but these are the global issues besetting our planet. And these are all very serious problems. For example, the global warming causing frequent occurrence of natural disasters. There's also the plastic waste, marine plastic waste. And also we are beset with the COVID-19 and infectious diseases. So these are some of the global issues besetting us today. It is also related to the fact that the world is connected. So today, I would like to talk about the plastic waste problem specifically. Now, mankind has brought about innovation to enrich society, and plastic is a good example of this. PET, or the general purpose plastic, is very light, strong, and easy to mold. It is also transparent and low cost. These are the characteristics of plastic, having a significant impact on society, needless to say. Innovation of expanding the use of plastics, that we have enjoyed the benefit on the part of mankind. However, there is also the shadow of technological innovation. It has brought about the plastic waste problem on a lagged basis. It is now coming to the fore. If we had cooperated from the beginning of the introduction of the plastics, we would not find ourselves in these dire straits. But because of the delay, the problem has become very serious. Therefore, in order to promote innovation, what we have to consider is not only the light, but also the shadow of technological innovation. It should be considered from the time of design. So we have to look at the light as well as the shadow of the plastics. Now, going back to the issue of the plastics, the total amount of plastic produced by mankind amount to 8 billion tons. Approximately 300 million tons of produced every year, and most are left as waste and garbage. And as a result, there is about 150 tons of plastics that are thrown away, and 8 million tons increase is seen every year. And there is also leakage of the plastics to the marine environment in countries without the appropriate infrastructure. Therefore, it is very important to understand the effectiveness of plastic and also promote 3R so that clean oceans can be realized and achieve the SDGs at the same time. This is we are trying to achieve under CLOMA, which stands for Clean Ocean Material Alliance. We have the CLOMA principles that are being shared, and key actions are being promoted. This is showing the key message of CLOMA. It's very simple. CLOMA aims to achieve 100% recycled plastic products such as packages and others by 2050 to contribute to reducing marine plastics. and conceptual diagram of recycling of plastic products are shown here. Key actions are identified. Now, for example, it includes the biodegradation material recycling and chemical recycling, as well as other actions are being promoted in five working groups. A roadmap is shown here for the five key actions. Material recycling will be explained. What is important here is the area outlined in orange, beverage PET, and others are being considered. For detergents as well as food, packaging it means that composite material are used. And we have to deal with the cleaning and municipalities as well as a distribution system will have to be involved to establish a system of recycling. These plans must be implemented and by 2030, in the 10 years, we have to achieve a 60% recycle rate by that time of 2030. So these are the proof of concept demonstrations that we have been conducting by 2022. Material recycling of toiletries was the starting point, and five key actions are being pursued in parallel. By 2023 and beyond, we will formulate the request for the system and proposal for the social system as well as expansion into Asia. On the part of CLOMA, we are involving all the components of the supply chain. We are also involving government, NGOs, finance, as well as industry to enable this process. Next, I would like to talk about the case studies toward the achievement of horizontal recycling. I would like to introduce three examples. First is recycling cooperation of film packages. Second is separate collection of film packages and demonstration experiment. And third is recycling design of film packages. We are, our company is involved in all these activities. I would like to introduce them one by one. Let me talk about the first example, which is the Lion Cow Film Container Recycling Corporation. I'm sure you know this well. In September of last year, we have made a joint announcement. So from competition to collaboration, and from diversification to centralization is what we are aiming for. So we are competing in our business, but for social issues, we are working with our peer companies. And the diversified effort will be centralized so that the social implementation can be facilitated. And we have been focused on recycling, the reduction of usage by focused on the container specification, sorting, as well as collection, transportation, recycling, as well as expansion of use in horizontal recycling. We have set up a technical team to enable this process. Let me give you this one example. This is one example of what we are implementing, sharing a film construction and the latest recycling technology. So it is a composite material of various layers. And in Kaol, there are different variations. And for Lion and other companies, different methods are utilized. And this is top secret information when it comes to the structure of the film packages. But we have disclosed information so that we can design and standardize film packaging, which can be recycled easily. Now, as for recent recycling, as introduced by the media, from the composite material, the film materials can be pelletized in this way, as you can see in the photograph. you can see that various molecules exist. And when we use the conventional method, there will be holes. And it cannot be used for packaging. But on the part of Kao, we are incorporating a chemical method. By so doing, we can have a micro uniformization of insoluble resin and particles. So this type of state-of-the-art information can be shared in the industry so that further improvements can be made. Monomaterials can be incorporated, which will lead to further closed loop or horizontal circulation. I would like to introduce the example we have with Ito-Yokado, which is recycling at the Hikibune store. We are also working with Lion in this area as well. So collection boxes are placed in the stores for recycling, as well as sorting information and pamphlets are being distributed. So for the issues that have been identified, we are making a tripartite effort to overcome the challenge. The third example will be introduced, which is regarding the recyclable design of the film packages. The Tokyo Metropolitan Government public project has adopted this zero emission challenge is where we hope to make a contribution. It's a resource recycling model business for horizontal recycling of one-way plastic. We will conduct a trial of monomaterial film packaging and a collection of film from reproduction bottle prototype, and Chroma Value Chain Corporation will be promoted. Specifically, the Toppan printing, as well as Ichikawa Environmental Engineering participating in Chroma, will collaborate to establish this value chain. Let me give you a further detailed explanation. So we are now promoting three steps. First is hand soap in monomaterial transparent film package will be distributed to public facilities in Koto Ward to be used by the consumers. From June of 2021, we will collect and palletize pouches after use of and horizontal recycle will be promoted for recycled bottles. And in the future, we will aim to realize complete horizontal recycling from film packages to film packages. And in this process, these are some of the milestones that we will be emphasizing in this demonstration project. Now, in terms of the mid to long term, we will aim to expand our effort to cover the food film package to food film package in the material working group of Chroma. We are currently engaged in investigation. Now, the technology and mechanism must be clarified through collaboration at Chroma. We hope that wide social implementation can be promoted. This is the last page. Chairman Sawada of Chroma is always emphasizing this point. As I mentioned at the outset, global issues are besetting us, and it is important to overcome the plastic waste problems. For Japan to take the lead in this area, we have to bring about significant movement. In order to enable this, we should introduce a success case from Japan, not just limited to Japan, but to communicate this globally, so that it will not just be a one-off success. We must have continuity of introducing these success stories. We should not just limit the activities It should not be a one-off success. Therefore, on the part of Glomma, we are making sure that these activities will be a viable business. This will be taken into consideration as we promote projects going forward. We will our platform to enhance the competitiveness of the companies in this field. Open platform will be utilized so that significant problems can be overcome. With that, I would like to conclude. Thank you for your kind attention. Thank you very much, Namba-san. Thank you very much for the clear explanation about the objectives of Glomma. Thank you very much. Next speaker will be from Sekisui Chemical Company Limited. Ms. Konishi will be providing the presentation. Konishi, over to you.
Hello, I am Konishi from Sekisui Chemical. Thank you for inviting me today. Nice to meet you all. Can you see the slide on the screen? Yeah, we can see it, all right? So I will begin. The circular economy is the title of the forum today. Many presentations have been delivered already, and I hope we can make our own contribution. Technology to produce ethanol out of waste to contribute to this circular economy. This is the content that I would like to cover today, background, overview, and the future picture. So we've been talking about the reducing of plastic waste. So in case of Japan, how much waste do we produce? This is the picture from the household and the businesses. In total, about 60 million tons of combustible waste. What about naphtha as plastic raw materials? Comparisons are made. Because we are to make ethanol, and using the ethanol make plastic, and we use them. So this is the loop that we are trying to realize. So how much plastic raw materials do we have now? About 30 million tons. In calorific value equivalent, it's about 200 to a trillion kilocalorie for the combustible waste. And this for the plastic raw material. So for the naphtha as a plastic raw material, we do have ample sources in terms of the tonnage of waste. Why do we have to produce ethanol? Because ethanol is a starting material for various chemical products like oil refinery. Naphtha is refined to make ethylene and polymerize it and use it as a final product. That has been the line. So we are aiming at having a biorefinery, and using the technology, waste will be turned into ethanol and make it into ethylene by taking the water out. And after the use is made, then that can be made into ethanol once again. So it kind of creates a circular loop. So sustainable resource circulation is what we are after. As Namba-san had mentioned, plastic have much merit, hard to carry, light, easy to mold and so forth. So plastic per se is no villain, but disposal has not been working right. So far, as we have listened to the presentations, there are packaging which can be reused or recycled. These are the undergoing efforts, but there are some which are not fit for reuse. So we are looking into combustible material. Garbage, wood, paper, and clothes, all these can become a resource. And using the gasification technology, it will be made into CO2 and H2. And using the microorganism, conversion will take place and make that into ethanol. So plastic will become plastic. It may not be a horizontal recycling to the true sense of the words, but this is a part of the recycling for sure. This is a process involved. So this is a starting material supply here. And here, gasification. After gasification, gas purification will take place. There's one more process is involved. Synthetic gas, CO and H2 will be refined. Contaminants will be removed to refine it and purify it. And the purification will take place here. Why is it necessary? Because at this stage, the microorganism will be involved to take in CO and carbon monoxide and H2. So microorganisms are used as a catalyst, which is a biological body, which means that if contaminants are there, then activities will be lessened and so forth, so that need to be adjusted. And put at the reaction tower reactor. The microorganisms are always there, minerals included. And the gas will be bubbled in from the pipe below, and it goes up within a few minutes. The microorganism will take in the gas and make ethanol. And that the microorganism comes from the biotech company in the United States, BasoTech, LanzaTech. And it will be distilled to up to 99.5% of purification or concentration. So this is a microorganism shape. Carbon monoxide and hydrogen are taken in by the microorganism and released. And LanzaTech is an inventor. This is a non-gene recombinant extractor from natural microorganism, same safety level as bread yeast. So way before the emergence of the human being, it's anaerobic, and it lives inside the body of a human being. And over 10 times the reaction rate of protozoa ethanol production, which is a very high efficiency, which is done by the LanzaTech, and we sourced the material from LanzaTech. So in terms of the material, the household refuse, as well as waste plastic and construction material waste are used as our resources. This is a general waste. And our pilot plant has been conducting demonstration. There are so many things which comes in, so various different gases will be produced. And that will be, if that is provided to the microorganism, it will not be good, so that the contaminants need to be removed, and that is a difficult process. The optimum condition need to be identified, and it took a few years dealing with different kinds of microorganisms. But thoroughly, contaminants are removed fully and make it to a pure gas. It can be done, but we have to factor in the costs. The microorganism will be active and make ethanol. To that extent, we have to heighten the elevated purity degree of the material. So by using the technology, what are the goals that we are aiming to achieve? This is a waste resource, plastics, clothing and paper and pulp and the woods, all the combustible waste can become a resources. And it will be gasified. And that gas, by use of microorganism, turn into ethanol. And that is where we develop the process. And it will be used for making plastic. And it's not written here, but it can be used as a fuel as well. So it is a formula with a cost involved, like a jet fuel, transport to fuel. And because of the pandemic, the ethanol are used to disinfect. So there are so many uses available for the use of ethanol. But if we are focusing on the circular economy, then plastic will be the focus. And together with other materials, it will be made into plastic so that the circular economy can become prevalent throughout the world. So far, the waste can be converted to electricity or to gas and so forth, but it can be made into ethanol. Chemical industry and others can be a user industry using ethanol as medication and so forth. So ethanol is versatile in its use purposes, and that is what is making my job interesting. We are working together with producers, and we would like to further co-develop with our partners. This is the stage that we are in Saitama. We have a pilot plant. It has been in operation since 2014, since 6 years ago. It's a very small size pilot plant, but in future, several hundred of tons, we hope to scale up because it pushes up the efficiency, and we would like to widen it to more full size experiment in terms of a second step. Maybe per day, 20 tons of raw material or waste can be converted to ethanol. And demonstration plant is being constructed in Kuji City in Iwate Prefecture. So in 1 year's time, trial operation would begin. This is the stage we are in. And a few years after, we will move on to the full-size to commercial plant scale. This is not only domestic Japan, but it's applicable in overseas region as well. So we really hope to operate in overseas, if possible. This is a schedule for commercialization. So I told you about this small pilot plant we have, which has been in operation since 2014, and the demonstration plant is being constructed now. And 1 year after from now, it will start the demonstration test. And the providers of the material together, we are working with them to make a market. And together with the end user of ethanol, we are co-developing the ethanol market. It's not us alone who are working on it. We have to collaborate. The material handler and the material users and so forth. So we need to work together with many business partners and stakeholders. So packaging story we heard today, the use, multiple use, it's quite encouraging. And the total volume by use can be reduced, but there are some things like medical use, goods and so forth, which cannot be recycled. by using our technology, it can be switched, turned into ethanol, and more convenient plastic use will always be there. So that, as I said, we hope to have this cycle circulate. I seek your cooperation and let's work together on it. Thank you.
Konishi-san, thank you very much for your outstanding presentation and providing an easy to understand presentation of technical content. Next, we'll hear from Unilever Japan. Shigeta-san, please. Hello, everyone. Just a moment, please. Good evening. My name is Shigeta of Unilever Japan. First of all, I would like to thank the Bureau of Environment of Tokyo Metropolitan Government for allowing me this opportunity and providing support for UMILE, the program that I'm going to introduce later. I would like to talk about the sustainability initiatives on the part of Unilever today. Now, let me give you an introduction. It's a company whose products are used by 2.5 billion people in 190 countries every day. In Japan, Unilever is famous for Lux, Dove, and Lipton tea. Let me talk about the Unilever's corporate activities guided by the philosophy of making sustainability a natural part of our daily business. Specifically, not just growing our business, but we must also reduce our environmental footprint to contribute to society, which is the raison d'etre for Unilever. Next, I would like to talk about how we want to implement a business growth by having an environmental footprint and a social contribution. I would like to talk about the Unilever Sustainable Living Plan established in 2010. We have three goals: contribute to the well-being of more than 1 billion people, reduce environmental footprint and product life cycle by half, to support the economic development of millions of people. 15 numerical targets of our activities have been identified. We mapped SDGs and our business activities. We found out that we contribute directly to 15 of the 17 goals of the SDGs and indirectly to remaining two. By promoting the Unilever Sustainable Living Plan, we will be able to contribute to the SDGs as a result. Now, we have been reducing the amount of plastic we use as a part of the Unilever Sustainable Living Plan. In October 2019, we established three new goals for plastic reduction by 2025. The first goal is to reduce the amount of non-recyclable plastic used by 50%. Second is to make 100% of plastic packaging reusable. And third, is to support the collection and processing of more plastic packages than the volume sold. As a company, we take responsibility for what happens to the products after they are used at home. Now, less plastic, better plastic, and no plastic have been promoted from 2017, which is reducing the amount better plastic means used materials that has a lesser environmental impact, and no plastic is to replace with other materials. We have established a common global framework. We designed a process to reduce the amount of plastic used and to promote recycling. Let me introduce examples in other countries. We are currently experimenting with business models in various parts of the world tailored to the conditions and to consumer needs of each market. Let me first of all talk about the examples of less plastic. The upper left image shows a product called Cif Ecofil, which is a detergent for kitchens. Launched in the UK in 2019, the product is now available in European countries, including Germany and France. It's a 10-time concentrated internal solution that is diluted with water. This is 75% less plastic than using regular pump bottle products. And In the UK, we have been able to reduce 131 tons in the first year. And 80% of the trucks have been reduced as well. This is almost dilutable below. It was introduced in Brazil in 2019. It is currently available in the South American countries. It is diluted in water. 70% plastic usage can be reduced. And it is recyclable to 100% level. Now, this is an example of the UK. And we have the refill service that is provided lower is the implementation we have in Indonesia. Counseling can be provided refilling service can be provided for the three tricycle, the refillable services are provided. Let me give you an example of less plastic. So we have introduced 100% recyclable and this is also example of Magnum, which is ice cream. A recyclable PP has been introduced for the first time in ice cream. This has been introduced in Belgium. 60,000 units have been introduced, expanded the sales channels to the Netherlands and Spain, and have now sold over 7 million units in Europe. We will be deploying this globally from this year onward. Let me now talk about the loop example. It will not be explained because it has been already introduced. Now, the toothbrush is shown on the right-hand bottom, which is using bamboo for the brushes. Let me talk about the three R's, which is more familiar in Japan, to talk about examples in Japan. Well, less plastic is becoming lighter, and changing the container from plastic to pouch. And for Unilever overall, we have been able to reduce by 100 tons. In 2009, by promoting reuse of bottles, expanding sales of refillable products in various sizes. Next is better plastics that we are now converting to recyclable materials. By so doing, we are able to utilize 52 million plastic bottles as resources. Compared to production of plastic from petroleum, we have been able to achieve a reduction of about 1,300 tons of CO2. Let me now talk about the example of the refill station in Japan. For people who are living in isolated areas, especially for elderly people, as a first step in Saku of the Nagano Prefecture, we have started the refilling service at the Michinoeki in Saku City. And the participants said that this is good to reduce plastic usage, and I'm glad that companies are making eco-friendly efforts even in rural areas. We will verify the effectiveness of this initiative and consider nationwide deployment by introducing the refill station. We aim to expand opportunities for consumers to have a casual and fun shopping experience that leads to eco-friendliness. Next, let me talk about the mono-material sachet. The conventional film packages used for refillable products such as shampoos have been used for years. The amount of plastic used is 70 to 90% less than that of bottles, but it is difficult to recycle as a material because it cannot be separated. To address this issue, we will launch the mono-material sachet, a film package made entirely of the PET material on April 7th. Going forward, although it has been a sachet type, we will also consider the conventional size to be introduced. Next I'd like to explain the UMAL project. This was a plan that I formulated, and we was being carried out of 11 young like-minded volunteers recruited from sales department. The reason why I say that I recruited volunteers is because we don't have a department in charge of sustainability and CSR. In other words, all the people had the day jobs, but they wanted to volunteer to participate in the project because of their strong passion to engage in activities that promote sustainability. Based on the common understanding of the team and respect of independence and individuality, we were able to act with speed. I would like to take this opportunity to thank the project members who are working so hard on this project. Next, let me give you the details of the UMILE program. What is UMILE? Plus, we are aiming to create a society where it will be the norm to recycle plastic. So in the daily lives, we want people to make a contribution to the reduction of their plastic usage and to establish a circular economy. Unilever is a manufacturer, and we have involved retailers as well as consumers. By so doing, we are hoping to make contribution to the circular economy. The way you can participate is to register as a LINE friend. And there is a QR code on this page. So if you have not registered yet, please proceed to do so. There are two ways to earn miles. The first is to buy refillable products. Take a picture of the refill product and the receipt at the time of the purchase. So you can earn one UMILE per product by sending to the LINE Talk. The second method is to earn new miles by recycling used empty containers. The collection boxes are located in the retail stores, and the consumers will bring the empty containers washed and dried. And by taking a picture with the collection box, you can earn 1 mile per product. So there are two methods to earn miles. It can be exchanged for goods, and you can make donations using the UMILE. So as 1 mile 20 yen can be used for shopping as well. For the containers that are collected, will be crushed, pelletized, and upcycled at the recycling plants. Next, I would like to talk about the key part of UMILE's effort, educating consumers. If used, empty containers are collected as they are. After they use, they will not be used again. And this is not sustainable. We want to have the consumers clean and dry before collection. And information is provided in this way. And we are also using social media to notify to the consumers. Now, let me deviate somewhat, as shown by the fact that Japan's recycling rate of beverage PET bottles is over 85% compared to 20% in the United States and 40% in Europe. The diligence of the Japanese people may seem unique from a foreign perspective, but I believe it suggests that possibility of resource recycling that can be realized uniquely by Japanese people. In other words, pouring out the inside of PET bottles, peeling off the label and separating it for recycling has somehow become a part of our lives. By the same token, with the diligence and culture of the Japanese people, we believe that we can clear the hurdle of wash, dry, and bring back that UMILE asks people to do. Fortunately, the majority of the products collected through UMILE have been washed and dried. We are seeing a good trend that is taking root in Japan. Now, we are also educating not only consumers, but also staff who make rounds to the stores as well as logistics service providers. Specifically, the reasons for implementing the UMILE program, basic knowledge of the waste management laws is taken as reference. And we, with the full understanding and cooperation of partners, so we are promoting the use of UMILE. Let me talk about the comprehensive collaboration agreement concluded between Saitama City and Shimatsu using UMILE. So within this agreement, Saitama City as well as Shimatsu provided a press release through the notification from Saitama City's official Twitter and Saitama City's official waste sorting app. UMILE has been introduced to 130,000 Saitama citizens. measures aimed at encouraging consumers to change their behaviors, such as Yuma product may be launched with fanfare at the start, but it has to permeate to consumers. Therefore, although it takes time and effort, we believe that it is necessary to make steady, careful, and continuous communication. We are very grateful that private sector companies and government have a common understanding of this effort. We hope to make further progress going forward. This is the last page of my presentation. There, U is included in UMIL. Obviously, it stands for Unilever, but also stands for Unite, Universal, and Unprecedented. What does this mean? It is important to transcend the industry barriers, and by uniting with local governments, promoting sustainability, and companies that are actively engaged in resource recycling to achieve our goal of establishing an unprecedented regional resource recycling zone. It represents our commitment through UMIL to establish a universal model of a nationwide resource recycling in Japan. This is a continuous process. So if there are municipalities or companies participating in this event today who are interested, we will be very happy to hear from you. We hope to work together to create a circular economy that is in conformity with the Japanese culture. Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Shigeta, for your outstanding presentation. You have talked about overseas cases as well as Japanese cases. The presentation was full of substance. Thank you very much. So we will proceed to the last speaker for the event from the United States, representing Pure Cycle Technologies. Mr. Dustin Olson will be making the presentation. Dustin-san, over to you.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay.
Could you proceed?
Thank you so much. Let me share my screen. Do my slides show up okay? Does it look okay?
Yes, it's okay.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for the opportunity to present to you today. It's a great honor to work with our friends in Japan. I remember 2 years ago being in Japan and walking along the cherry blossoms, and it's a very beautiful time of year in Japan right now. I wish I was with you. Before we start, can I ask a technical question? Will there be a translator for this presentation or just me?
Yes. The presentation is simultaneously translated in English.
Okay, so I can just talk and then the translation will happen without me hearing it, correct?
Yes, of course.
Okay. Thank you so much. Well, thank you again for the opportunity to speak to you today about our technology. Our company is called Pure Cycle Technology, and we have a very unique and technically advanced operation that we are currently scaling around the world. Our process takes plastic waste and turns it into virgin-like quality polypropylene with zero compromise. My name is Dustin Olson. I'm the Chief Manufacturing Officer for Pure Cycle Technology. I come with many years of experience working in Europe, working and living in Europe, working and living in the United States, and working and living in China. My last position was based in Shanghai, and I just recently moved back to the United States from that opportunity. We at PureCycle, we're working to transform the world. we're working hard to provide our customers a solution without compromise. We want to provide a polypropylene, a recycled polypropylene pellet back to our customers that they can use without constraint. You can see through our slide here that we have a very good relationship with Procter & Gamble. That technology has been licensed to us. And you can see the awards that we have won by many, many institutions for the technology. This is a unique solvent-based extraction and purification technology that does a really good job of cleaning, kind of washing the polypropylene and returning a virgin-like polypropylene product in the end. This technology, as has been said by many, many institutions, has the capability to revolutionize the plastics recycling industry by enabling us to bring P&G's technology to the world to tap into all sorts of recycled plastics. We wouldn't be on this call with you today if we didn't all agree that plastic waste is a global crisis. It is a problem that everyone sees in the world. There's no debate on if it is real or not real. It is right in front of us everywhere that we look. We know that it is a use and then lose situation. We use it and then we immediately throw it into the waste, into the landfills. Very, very low percentages of polypropylene are recovered, less than 1% globally. And that's much lower than the plastic recycling rate for other types of plastic. And we also know that most plastics, when they are recycled, they come with limitations. They come with, you can use it, but it will have a little odor, or it can only be used in black parts, or don't use it inside the car, only use it outside the car. So the limitations placed on polypropylene going into the market is very high. And then we also know that this has been a big global impact. Okay, decades and decades and decades of unchecked disposal is just now collecting and building across the planet. PureCycle is here to change that. There's one other key point to mention about our product. It's polypropylene. Polypropylene is the most, it's one of the lightest plastics in the world. It's one of the most used plastics in the world. And quite frankly, the growth plan for polypropylene is straight up. Yet there's not a good recycling plan for polypropylene today. And this is where PureCycle believes we can step in to change that. PureCycle has been very successful over the last 6 months in securing financing for our first plant. Our first plant is due to start up in Q4 of 2022, and I'm proud to say that we are on schedule. We have many years of preparation to get to this point. We have a pilot plant already in operation that is very successful and very robust. We closed the bond, our first bond, in Q3 of last year, to secure financing for plant number one. We announced that we would become a public company in Q1 of 21. And we are also working with the FDA to get the letter of non-object. And we anticipate getting that later this year for portions of the FDA requirements. And then our scaling, we intend to scale the technology very quickly. When we become a public company, we will have access to capital funds and we will be able to scale Our primary focus will be in the United States, but we are also looking globally, also looking for partners to partner with us globally to grow very quickly. You can see this picture here at the top. The black pellets are traditional recycled polypropylene, and that's because it's very costly to sort color. And even when you sort color, there are millions of different types of colors. And so you end up pushing it all together and making black, which makes it very difficult to use because it stays into a very limited market. But then you see our pellets on the right, the future, and we extract all of the additives, all of the elastomers, all of the dyes out of the pellet and return a pure virgin polypropylene. In fact, in some ways, our polypropylene is actually better than virgin because the odor is slightly lower than virgin polypropylene. Our process is very technical. It's not traditional recycling. It's a solvent-based extraction technology. And so we take any number of feeds, of which we have, you can take the 3 to 7 bales. You can take enhanced polypropylene, like a number 5 bale. You can pre-process that bale to further purify and remove some of the post-consumer waste. We can take post-industrial waste into our plant. We've done this successfully across many, many, many different types of feeds. We have brought metallized polypropylene. We've brought fiber. We've brought film. We've brought rigids. We've brought post-industrial waste. We've brought post-consumer waste into our plants. Our plant is extremely robust, and then we extract that that feedstock. We remove the rest of the impurities. There's no reaction. So what you get, what you bring into the plant is what you will get out. Let me be very clear. There is no chemical reaction with this plant. This is like an example or an analogy of what this plant is this is like a molecular wash for the plant, okay? So it's as if we're taking the molecules of polypropylene and we're pushing them through a washing machine to take everything out, okay? By doing it the way that we do it, there's very little, in fact, basically zero polymer degradation. And the product that comes out the plant is the virgin quality polypropylene. We're very confident in our ability to get FDA approval, a letter of non-object for food content applications. And we're, as I mentioned before, we are in the process of doing that. After the extraction, we will filter to remove talc or TiO2 or other solid contaminants, and maybe some small molecular contaminants. And then we go through traditional product processing like extrusion so that we can pelletize. And then the product here on the end is an example of what we make. I can tell you personally that I have held products off of the line and they look exactly like the product here on the left bottom. The idea is that because we have zero chemical reactions in our process, our plastic can be used over and over and over. So in some processes, you'll bring plastic in and you'll destroy the polymer. You'll break down the polymer and then push it in as a feedstock. We don't do that. We preserve all of the work and all of the energy and all of the care that has been put into the polymer the first time. We keep that, we reuse that, and we let that polymer circulate again. It's truly a circular process. An example of some of the differences here between polypropylene recycling at PureCycle versus mechanical and chemical recycling. We've already touched on the first line here, which is end use applications. There is no limitation where our product can go. It is equivalent or better than virgin polypropylene. Very high value, can go into any application. It can go into a bumper. It can go into an airbag. It can go into a plastics, rigid applications for toys. It can go into film for food, okay? Our polypropylene can go into everything. And this is why we say with mechanical and chemical, there's low value because they have very limited applications. Mechanical is limited by odor and by color and other concerns. FDA approval on mechanical is very difficult. And then with chemical, it's low value because it's converted down either to base refinery fuel stock products, lubricants, fuel oil, or it's turned into feed for olefins plants. As far as a cost goes, PureCycle is an extremely energy efficient plant, and we are getting better every day. We will have a stronger position on energy every day as we scale our plants because we're going to get better and better at designing. But we're pretty close to mechanical and much lower than chemical. Contaminant free. We remove all metals, we remove all dyes, we remove all additives, we remove all elastomers, the rubber component that gives impact strength to polypropylene. We remove all of that. And mechanical and chemical recycling do not. Mechanical cannot remove those contaminants. Chemical recycling destroys the polymer and therefore doesn't remove it. It just destroys it. Food grade application. We have the capability to be food grade application on our side. And then the others do not. And then lastly, I call it value creation. As I mentioned before, we can go anywhere. Our products can be used anywhere. And so it's direct plastic waste to final product sales. However, mechanical recycling, it's very limited because of limited applications. And with chemical recycling, the point I really want to make here is, remember, it becomes a feed to olefins, a feed to the refinery. And after that, you have to add carbon footprint, you have to add energy, you have to add many, many, many steps to get to the same place the PureCycle is. So PureCycle, you bring plastic waste into one plant, and out of that plant is a strong good product. Chemical recycling, you bring it into a plant, you destroy the polymer, and then you send it to another plant, and then send it to another plant, and then send it to another plant before you finally get it to the same place the PureCycle is after one plant. I mentioned this once before, but there's really no limitation to the types of feedstock that we can bring in. Some feedstocks will require more feed processing than others, more washing, more cleaning, maybe some sorting, but that CapEx requirement is much lower. And in the end, if there is some contamination that comes into the feed for PureCycle's plant, it's okay. It might use some capacity on the plant, but it will not destroy the quality of the product. We will be able to separate those out of the plant or out of the product. We've built a feedstock evaluation unit in Ironton, Ohio. This is a picture of the plant. The black vial at the top is advanced carpet fiber. So this is polypropylene carpet that we have created a pelletized form and then sent it to the plant, and you end up with a pure on the bottom. We've processed hundreds of feedstocks. We're very confident in all of them. The product, the plant runs very well. We're very confident in the plant. And we're, you know, we have the process is underway with the FDA. We've partnered with several big names. L'Oreal, P&G is a strong partner with us on this. They've helped with the technology. Milliken, Total, Aptar Group, Ravago. Leidos is an independent engineering firm that's validated the technical competence of our facility. As I mentioned before, this is not a theoretical solution. This is a solution that is being built today at scale. We have a 50 KT plant being built in Ironton, Ohio. It will start in Q4 of next year, and we will have much more capacity coming online. Our goal is to have 1 billion pounds of capacity by the end of 2024. The picture at the bottom says a lot. The virgin resin is a little cloudy. The PCT with the high performance recycled polypropylene, ultra pure recycled polypropylene with zero additives. So the second cup is similar to the first cup, okay, virgin versus our product. And you can see that our cup is a little bit clearer without additives. And then when you add Milliken additive packages to it, you can see just how beautiful the cup becomes. We're very interested in partnering. We see Japan as a very strong potential market for us because the character, the order, the work that Japan does to sort and purify the recycle streams, we believe this is a great opportunity for us to partner with both the government of Japan as well as partners in Japan to build capacity in your country. Thank you very much for your time. I'm right on time, I think, and I appreciate your attendance.
Okay, thank you very much. Domo arigatou gozaimashita.
Thank you very much. The recycled technology as well as new research and development activities in the United States was introduced. With that, that concludes all the presentations scheduled for today. Thank you very much for your participation today. Now, those of you who have completed the webinar, please fill in the questionnaire before you leave us. Now, on the part of the Bureau of Environment of Tokyo Metropolitan Government, we will be partnering with the various actors to further promote to reduce, reuse, and recycling for a sustainable economy. With this, we would like to conclude the Circular Innovation Forum that has been organized by the Bureau of Environment, DMG, as well as the EXA Research Institute. Thank you very much.